So glad you're with us here today to celebrate Christmas as we start the Christmas countdown and the time to remember the season. Let's stand this morning and let's lift our voices together. We sing Angels We Have Heard on High.
You'll notice my mic is red. We're going to do a stand-up routine while we're up here. Okay. If you'll notice outside the doors out there, there's a Christmas tree, and it was all pretty, and we covered it with a bunch of envelopes out there. And each of those envelopes is numbered from $1 up to $100. And we've decided to do a summer camp fundraiser around Christmas time so that we could give the gift of summer camp coming up in the future. And I don't want you to think of it necessarily as just another fundraiser. Think of it more as an investment in these students' lives. We are trying to make it so that the kids in our church don't have to pay anything to go to summer camp this year because of the impact that it has in their life. And actually, if we were to fill all of those envelopes, we're going to end up with somewhere around $5,500, which is a lot of money for summer camp, which is going to allow us to do some other things with it because we don't have that many kids that go to summer camp, but we would also like them to bring their friends that don't know Jesus with them to summer camp. So if you would, on your way out today, stop and grab an envelope. I think there's only two that have been taken already. The $1 and the $5 are already filled. But just grab an envelope, fill it with the amount on it, and bring it back. You can give it to me, you can give it to Kim, whoever, whatever works for you. If you were like, hey, I really wanted to give $100, but the $100 envelope is taken already, you know what? You can take the 98 and the 2. Right there, there's $100. However you want to do it, be creative. If you wanted to take the $3 one, that's fine too. We appreciate everything. Thank you.
They can take the entire tree.
Yes.
Just as long as they fill the envelopes. Okay. There's always one of those guys in the crowd, isn't there? Hey, just a reminder that we're having aftermath upstairs. following worship service, where we discuss application of the message. This will be the last Sunday of December that we will have aftermath, and then we will resume that again after the first of the year. We're celebrating the Lord's Supper today, and so rather than hand that out, we're going to invite you to come up and take your own elements with that. There's buckets up here. If you had brought an offering with you that you would like to leave there, feel free to be able to do that. There is a basket on the back chair, because also on the first Sunday of every month, we take up a benevolent offering to help those in need at the end of our service. So feel free to give as the Holy Spirit leads you. There's envelopes on the back table. I just want to thank you all for your continued generous giving. I want to remind you, if you have not been looking at your weekly announcements that Kim puts via email, we are having a Christmas Eve candlelight service here, Friday, December 6th. Feel free to invite family and friends and neighbors. We will be starting at 6 o'clock and doing our best to end by 7, so you can still go home and have some hot chocolate and open up gifts and do all sorts of things. Yes?
Is it on December 6th?
I'm sorry, December 24th. I have no idea what I said, but hey, it's all I know is it's better than last week so far, right? I'm starting out better than last week. Trivia is 6 days away, next Saturday. I think we have 2 or 3 tables. We'll do it if we have 3 tables, you know. It's not a fundraiser. It just is a night out to have some fun. Yes, there's a fee, $10 a table, and what we'll do is we'll take and combine all that, and the winning table gets all the proceeds. So come have a fun night with that. I want to read a prayer request for you. Please keep this in mind during prayer time. I would like you to be praying for Ben Benham, who has been moved to a nursing care facility this week due to complications with his advancing dementia. Hospice care has also started, and so, you know, feel free to pray for the family. You can send Marge texts or cards or notes. But at this time, don't give her a call. You know, it's not like she doesn't want to talk to you. There's just so much going on. So, you know, send any words of encouragement via text or cards or note or whatever else like that. If you would like to send a card to Ben, I have an address here. I could tell that to you, but it'd be better off just getting it from the office or for Linda or Dean. He's in Douglas. And again, at this time, the family is restricted from any other visitors, so the best that you can do is pray for Ben, Marge, the family, during this difficult time. So let's look to the Lord and ask for his blessing on this service. Father, we give you thanks and praise for this opportunity to gather in person. What a challenging time, but yet what a time of blessing. We pray, Father, that you would open up our eyes to see Jesus and move in our hearts, draw us closer to him. Pray that your Spirit would fall upon us this morning and lift up the name of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing together, Emmanuel, at Manger Ground.
What hope we hold this starlit night, the King is born in Bethlehem. Our journey long, we seek the light that leads to the hallowed manger ground. What fear we felt in the silent years can he be found, but broken by a baby's cry, rejoice in the hallowed manger ground. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God Son of God, here born to bleed, a crown of thorns would pierce his brow, and we beheld this offering, exalted now, the King of Kings. Praise God for the hallowed manger cry. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God incarnate, here to dwell.
Week two of Advent. The second week of Advent focuses on peace. As the prophet Isaiah reminds us, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Isaiah 9:6. It's my father's favorite. This Prince of Peace was born in a manger nearly 2,000 years ago. There were no parades held in his honor. There were no feasts celebrating his birth. For the most part, from an earthly perspective, his birth was hardly noticed. However, it would accomplish two amazing things. As the angelic host declared in the presence of some shepherds, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to men on whom his favor rests," in Luke 2:14. The entrance of the Prince of Peace into the world would bring glory and honor to Almighty God, and it would bring peace to those upon whom the favor of God rests. And as we light the second candle, maybe, it will remind us that peace can be ours, a peace that transcends understanding. What began in Bethlehem will ultimately be fulfilled when Jesus returns again. For time without end, all will be the way God intended it for it to be. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Romans 15:13.
Thank you. love so undeserving, love so undeserving, and you shine for all the world to see. Let the nations hear our plea. We will lift you up higher, higher. You will show yourself stronger, stronger. There's power in your name, forever you will reign. We will lift you up higher, higher. You will show yourself stronger, stronger. For you laid down your life, no greater sacrifice, Jesus. My guilt and shame, love was poured out for us, love was poured out for us, Jesus. The grave you overcame, that power is within us, power is within us, and you shine for all the world to see. Let the nations hear our plea. Higher, higher, you will show yourself stronger, stronger. There's power in your name, forever you will reign. We will lift you up higher, higher. You will show yourself stronger, stronger. For you laid down your life, no greater sacrifice.
So, got the cast off. Yoo-hoo! You know, it's a weird thing when someone comes up to you and says, "Wow, I haven't seen you in pants for a while." How am I supposed to get, what does that mean? Yes, I am wearing something here, okay, see? Okay. Yeah, I know. Don't want to leave that burned in your mind, right? Hey, I wanted to share something during announcements, and I chose to just wait till the beginning of the message to do that. Again, I had shared last week that, things are a lot different this year than they were last year as far as pandemic restrictions and so on and so forth. But again, last year, the Delta strain was really taking over and infecting a lot of individuals. And if you heard on the news now you got the Omicron variant that I watched Friday, said it was in one state, and now it's in all kinds of states and multiple reports and stuff like that. So I'm believing it's going to happen the same thing as it did last year. So I will be wearing a mask unless I am preaching by choice. All right, I have a house full of individuals. I have a one-week-old granddaughter. I don't want to give anything to anyone anywhere. So if I don't shake your hand or something else like that, I'm not being unsociable or whatever else. I'm just doing whatever I can do on my part, not only to keep myself as safe as possible, but to keep you as safe as possible. And you need to be able to do the same thing. All right? Just try in the upcoming months to just stay as safe as possible, whatever that means for you. If you want to wear a mask, into worship, go ahead and do that. If you don't, I guess that's up to you as well. What I would ask is if we do a little bit more concerted effort, we got so much space, can you distance yourself more from individuals? Again, I'm not your daddy. I'm not making you do anything. That's up to you. You have to take that responsibility to keep you, yourself, safe. If you choose not to come, because that will be safest for you, I understand that. I just really enjoy getting together and worshiping with you face to face. So I want to do whatever I can do on my part to contribute to that so we can continue doing that. Christmas is only 20 days away, and for most of us, these 20 days are just going to fly by. And then, on Christmas or Christmas Eve, depending on what your family does, by tradition, you'll probably open up a bunch of gifts. Some individuals have a hard time with that because of the commercialism, but it doesn't have to be that way, because gift giving can remind us of that gift that we received 2,000 years ago when the Prince of Peace left heaven and entered our world as an infant to sacrifice his life so that you and I could receive peace with God. You see, peace with God only comes through Jesus Christ. There's no other way that it can come about. It's the greatest gift that one could ever receive. Our scripture today focuses on peace, and it deals with something that Jesus said to his disciples after he spent a significant amount of time telling them that he would eventually leave them. Not going to be able to be here forever. I'm going back to the Father. I'm going to turn you loose. Carry on this ministry. If I were there listening to that, I would have been pretty anxious, I would have been pretty concerned. Like, you're doing what? You're going where? What about us? What about me? I'm sure their hearts may have been troubled. Fear may have set in. After all, they had been with Jesus for a significant amount of time. Over 3 years. How could they possibly imagine life without him? But Jesus tells them why he has to leave them. Because after he is gone, another comforter will be coming. Another counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in his name, who will teach them all things and remind them of everything that Jesus said to them. Not a bad trade-off. And then Jesus says this. He said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Man, I love these words from Jesus. In this passage, the Prince of Peace addresses the very subject of peace. Now, again, for most of us, when we think along the terms of peace, we think along an absence of war, which is kind of strange for me, because it seems like no matter what year it is, no matter what day it is, the world isn't experiencing a total sense of peace. Somewhere in the world is at war. But this is not the kind of peace that Jesus is referring to. When we think of the term peace, we sometimes think along the lines of a feeling or an emotion, don't we? You know, we think about a time where maybe we're not feeling a sense of anxiety or uncertainty in the decisions that we're thinking about taking. We make such a comment as, you know, I got to make this decision and I've been praying about it and I'm just at peace with this decision. Maybe you've said something like that before in the past. That's not the peace that Jesus is referring to. Because you can have a feeling of peace that lacks anxiety or depression or uncertainty and still not experience the peace that Jesus was referring to in this verse. Now, why do I see that? Well, peace is more a lack of is more than a lack of conflict. It's more than just some kind of emotion, although both of those elements may play a small part in what Jesus is talking about. But the peace that Jesus is talking about is more likened to the Hebrew term shalom. Have you ever heard that? Shalom. Shalom's an interesting word. It's kind of a multifaceted word. If instead of Rob coming up here and saying good morning or something like that, he could have said shalom, and he would have used it in a proper context. At the end of the service, when I say, okay, God bless you, you're dismissed, go live out your faith, I could literally say shalom, and I would be using it in a proper way. But shalom means more than just a greeting or a goodbye. It has more depth to it. Shalom has to do with harmony. It has to do with wholeness. It has to do with completeness. Where there is shalom, it means that a person, a place, or a situation is the way God intends for it to be. Now, ingrain that in your memory, will you? Shalom is the way that God intends for it to be, whether it's a person, or a place, or a situation. And therefore, when I think about this, I think that peace is kind of a twofold thing. It's a legacy and it's a treasure. Let's look at peace from the standpoint of it being a legacy. Jesus said this. He said, "My peace I leave with you." Now, oftentimes we don't think much of a legacy, but a legacy is received from someone who has died. Therefore, it can be also understood as the inheritance of a gift. Now, we're familiar with an inheritance, right? That kind of concept. An inheritance of a gift. Gifts are a good thing. I like receiving gifts. Don't you like receiving gifts? I mean, isn't that why we give them to one another during this holiday season? This legacy, this inheritance, this gift of peace that Jesus leaves with us is a peace that is secured through his atoning death on the cross. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, to atone means to pay the price for something or to cover over sins so that we may receive forgiveness. It has to do with the turning away the wrath of God that comes as a result of sin. Now, when Jesus shed his blood on the cross, he paid the price for sin. In other words, he appeased or turned aside the wrath of God. His death atoned for our sins. So Jesus says, "Peace I leave you." It's our legacy. Again, a legacy is something that's received from someone who has died. So through his death, we have peace with God. It's his gift to us. It's what he leaves us. You understand? Now, today is the first Sunday of the month. And for many, many, many years, we've celebrated the Lord's Supper communion on the first Sunday of the month. We say that it's a time that we set aside to remember Christ's death and his burial and his resurrection. It's done in a spirit of hope. as we anticipate that time when Jesus is going to return again, and a time when we will be with him forever. And so how appropriate on this Communion Sunday that we remember that it's through Christ's blood, through his death on the cross, that we receive peace. Our relationship with Almighty God is once again in harmony. Before we came to Christ, it was in disharmony. But now, through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, our relationship with him is the way God intends for it to be. I mean, how's that for a legacy, right? I'm excited about it, even if you're not. What a gift. And not only is it a legacy, it's also a treasure. Jesus said, "My peace I give you." This is the time of the year when most of us, again, are giving gifts to loved ones. And man, as a kid, as a child, I always looked forward to receiving gifts at Christmas time. You know, ripping open the wrappings on there and, you know, tearing open the box to see what I would get. I didn't get them because I earned those gifts. Those are mine. I earned them. I paid the price. Don't you touch my gift. They were given to me out of love. And you can consider the peace Jesus gives us as a gift, because we can't buy it. We can't earn it. He gives it to us out of love. Out of love. Because we're in Christ, we're given the peace of Christ. It's a peace that guards our hearts and our minds. What does it guard our hearts and minds against? It guards our hearts and minds against trouble. It guards our hearts and minds against fear. I mean, what an amazing gift, don't you think? Why do I say it's a treasure? Well, a treasure is something that we highly prize, right? I mean, a treasure is something that is considered very precious. It's something that's highly valued by the owner. I have a book that I treasure, that I consider very precious to me. I haven't read it because it's written in the English language that was common to the day in the late 1700s. I think the book was published in like 1780, 1790, and it's a book of messages from George Whitefield. And so the printing and everything else like that is really kind of weird. You know, the S's look like F's, and that just plays with my mind. Someday, I'm going to take the time and just read it through. But I keep it away from everything else. I treasure that book because it's very precious to me. It's something highly valued by the owner. It's something that could be considered valuable in a monetary sense. The gift of peace that Jesus gives us, it's priceless. It's priceless. It's like unlike anything else that the world can possibly offer. And Jesus made this very clear when he said, "I do not give to you as the world gives. My giving is different." He's making a contrast between the peace that he gives and the peace that the world gives. What should cause us then, shouldn't it, to reflect on what kind of peace does the world give us? As I had mentioned earlier, again, in some sense, we often associate peace with a lack of conflict. Countries sign agreements to reduce weaponry or to redraw boundaries, right? They sign accords to strive for a specific purpose. They do things like this so that as far as they can control, we can establish world order or world peace, even though those of us who are in Christ Jesus know fully well that that's only happening when Jesus comes back again. It's not going to be because of the United Nations or NATO or anything else like that. True worldwide peace is only going to happen when Jesus returns again. You see, whenever peace is contingent upon human ability and human circumstances, listen, it is temporary at best. It's never going to last. Eventually, peace will fade or it'll diminish because people and circumstances change. And when change takes place, anxiety surfaces. After all, in life, there are some things that you can control, and there are some things that you cannot control. The peace that Jesus gives is not like the kind of peace the world offers. Why? Well, it's not like the world because the world is not concerned about bringing a person or a place or a situation to be the way God intends for it to be. I mean, the world's standard and the world's measurement of peace is not the same as God's standards. It's not seeking after God. It's not striving to obey His will. It's not looking to bring honor and glory to God. It's all about self. That's why the peace Jesus gives us is such a treasure. I mean, you and I are living in a world that is saturated with anxiety. I mean, we have supply shortages. So what are we going to do if we don't get the kind of gifts that we want for Christmas? First world problem, right? What if I mail them out to my son living on the West Coast and he doesn't get them in time? First world problems. The retailers are having difficulty getting inventory. Crazy. What are we going to do? Last year, COVID caused all sorts of anxiety. And this year, anxiety was spread, as I mentioned, by the Delta variant. And now what's knocking on the door? A new strain. Omicron. Because it's only cool if you can name them after Greek letters. I remember in our theology class, even in every class, you know, you're looking at some Latin terms for things, and you want to really sound cool and intelligent to other individuals. Use these Latin terms. Not that you're going to learn Latin, but ooh, what's that? That's Latin? Wow. It's pretty cool. There's always going to be something that causes us anxiety. And from the world's perspective, anxiety causes peace to flee. I believe that's why the Holy Spirit moved the Apostle Paul to address this with the church at Philippi when he wrote, "Do not be anxious about anything. But in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7. What a great passage. I don't know if you've ever considered this, but the peace that Jesus leaves, and the peace Jesus gives is still present today. It's still present, even if we're facing difficult circumstances. Circumstances that may be causing you anxiety. It's still present even if you're facing trials and adversities. It's still a legacy and a gift, even though your world may be crashing down around you. You see, God never promised us a life that will be free from conflict. He never promised us a life to be free from trials. He never promised that you would never, ever, ever feel anxiety. however he provided a way for us to rise above those things. He's given us peace in Jesus Christ, a peace that allows us to be able to cope and function as we are supposed to function as kingdom citizens, because this peace will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. The peace of God covers our spiritual and our earthly needs. For example, the peace Jesus leaves allows one to enter into the kingdom of God in the first place, right? That relationship that's been destroyed as a result of sin is now in harmony with God, right? We are able to enter into the kingdom of God by grace through faith. That peace Jesus leaves deals with our vertical relation with Almighty God. The peace Jesus gives deals with our earthly circumstances and with our relationship with other individuals that are created in the image of God. It deals with living in this world according to kingdom principles, not according to the world's principles. We play by a higher standard, my friends. We're governed by a higher standard, not earthly principles, but kingdom principles. And this peace transcends all human understanding. I don't know why I'm facing this. I don't know why this circumstance is causing anxiety. I don't understand it, but God does. And this peace guards our hearts and our minds from anxiety and from trouble. Today's scripture passage is found in a body of teaching that is often called the farewell discourse. And it begins in John 13 and runs through the 17th chapter. It's a lengthy portion of scripture. It's Jesus' final interaction with his disciples before his arrest and before his crucifixion. And the farewell discourse covers a number of different topics, which I'm sure had to deal with or cause a lot of anxiety in his followers. Jesus didn't share these things to freak out his disciples. And in the last verse of chapter 16, Jesus reveals this motivation behind everything that he has just shared. And he tells his disciples this. He says, I've told you these things. Here's my reasoning. I have told you these things so that in me, you may have peace. In this world, you'll have trouble. But take heart. I have overcome the world. John 16:33. Take heart. The world can't possibly offer the kind of peace that Jesus gives. Yes, it may give us a brief reprieve from our troubles, but that can't ever last. Jesus said in this world, we will have trouble. He should know, right? But he also told us to take heart because he has overcome the world. Do you know what that means? That means because you and I are in Christ, we're overcomers. How about that? We're overcomers as well. Because of the peace Jesus leaves, we can take the peace that he gives into the world, into our own little corners of existence, so that a person or a place or a situation may be the way God intends for it to be. Listen, this is the greatest gift that you can ever give to anyone else. Anyone else. This gift was given freely to us so that we can keep it and so that we can give it away. Give it away to others. I like to think of this as regifting. Back in 1985, the sitcom Seinfeld had an episode entitled The Label Maker, And in that episode, Jerry gives Dr. Tim Whatley two Super Bowl tickets because he's unable to make it to the Super Bowl because he has to go to a wedding. And Whatley is so thankful for that, he gives Jerry a thank you gift back in return, which is this label maker. And when Jerry shows this to Elaine, they both start freaking out because she realizes that's the exact identical label maker she gave Dr. Whatley as a gift. And thus the world has was introduced to the term re-gifting. And we've used that term ever since. Now in that episode, re-gifting was viewed as a negative thing, right? Cheap. How could you re-gift something else? However, as far as giving to others the gift of peace that God gives us, listen, re-gifting is not viewed as something negative. It's a treasure. This is an expectation that God has of us, and it's a gift that will be treasured by those who receive it. As our Advent reading stated, Jesus is the Prince of Peace. That means the fruit of His presence is peace. Jesus came to bring wholeness and harmony, wholeness and shalom to all of creation, including you and I. And that's why His peace is our legacy, our inheritance. Peace with God. And His peace is also our treasure. Something that we treasure, something we give to others. As I had mentioned, following prayer time, we'll be celebrating the Lord's Supper. We're going to be reflecting on this new covenant that Jesus ushered into through His blood. Will you keep in mind that we have a legacy that can only come through Jesus. We play no role in our securing peace with God. All we can do is receive this gift that He offers to us. Would you also keep in mind that we have a treasure that not only comes through the Spirit uses us to spread this treasure, to give it away, to spread peace throughout the world. And you know, the primary way that we spread this is through human relationships. As we interact with others, we have opportunities to bring shalom into the world. Do you realize that there are somewhere between 55 and 60 one another passages that are mentioned in the New Testament that inform us how we can contribute to helping other things or people or situations be the way that God intended for them to be? Different ways that we can help bring about shalom? Let me quickly go through all 55 with you. No, just kidding. What I am going to say is that all these ways, 55, 60 different ways, all fall under something that Jesus had commanded His disciples. This command is all-encompassing. Love each other as I've loved you. It's spread by us as we live out kingdom principles. It's lived as we are zealous to do good works for the honor and glory of God. It is spread as you and I, as kingdom citizens, serve our Lord, again, doing everything for His glory. For instance, if you were here this past summer in our study on Romans 12, verses 9 through 21, you may remember that that includes hating evil and clinging to good. Hey, listen, that brings about peace. We're to be joyful in hope. We're to be patient in affliction. We're to be faithful in prayer. We are to share with God's people who are in need. We're to practice hospitality. We're to bless those who persecute us rather than curse them. Man, that's a toughie.
or to rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. We ought to refrain from becoming proud or conceited. We're to seek to live in harmony with one another. We must never repay evil for evil. We have to be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. And as far as it depends on us as individuals, we're to live at peace with everyone. With everyone. So we can't take revenge on others. And if our enemy's hungry, we have to feed him. And if he's thirsty, we have to give him something to drink. Because when all is said and done, we must overcome evil with good. Living out kingdom principles brings about the peace that Jesus gives and the peace that Jesus leaves. It brings the kingdom of God into our spheres of influence. It helps contribute to creating an environment that is the way God intends for it to be. So as we partake of the elements, may they remind us that He expects us to take peace into all areas of our lives. So that as far as it is possible on our part, things may be the way God intends for them to be. Again, shalom is ultimately God's work. He alone is the only one who is capable of establishing peace. However, God uses us to bring this peace into mankind, into our world. So we can't shirk our responsibilities. Don't do that. That's why Scripture commands us, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Now, you and I can't control every person or place or situation so that it becomes the way God intends for it to be. That's not our responsibility. That's God's responsibility. Our responsibility is to share the peace that Jesus leaves with us. So carry out your responsibility. On the second Sunday of Advent, as we prepare to partake of the Lord's Supper, may we focus on Jesus' words, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you." It's your legacy. It's your treasure. May we focus on Jesus' words, "I do not give to you as the world gives." His peace is unlike anything this world offers. And when the cares of this world try to shake your spirit, focus on Jesus' words, "Do not let your heart be troubled, and do not be afraid." He's overcome the world, making us overcomers. Let's spend some time in prayer before we partake of the Lord's Supper. Maybe there's something that you need to cast upon Him because you've been feeling a bit anxious. Claim these promises as your own and let the peace of God guard your hearts and your minds. Let's pray as the Spirit leads. Don't tell my doctor I'm doing this. I'm in trouble. I'm going to invite you to stand and come forward and partake of the elements. Do me a favor, please. Would you distance yourselves? I know I say that every Communion Sunday, but some of you need to realize distancing means a little bit more distance. So do that. Let's come.
Some children see him lily white, the baby Jesus born this night. Some children see him lily white, with the tresses soft and fair. Some children see him bronzed and brown, the Lord of heaven to earth come down. Some children see him bronzed and brown, with dark and heavy. Some children see him on the die, the Savior whom we kneel beside. Some children see him on the die, with skin of golden hue. Some children see him dark as day, sweet Mary's son to whom we pray. Some children see him dark as day, and oh, they love him too. The children in each different place will see the baby Jesus' face, like theirs, but bright with heavenly grace and filled with holy light. Aside each earthly thing, and with thy heart as offering, come worship now the infant King. 'Tis love that's born tonight. Thank you.
man, how cool would it have been to have been there, right? Did I have a responsive reading or no? No? Okay. So on the night that he was arrested, Jesus took bread, and he broke it, and he gave thanks, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. As often as you eat, do so in remembrance of me." Remember, the peace of Jesus is our legacy. Let's eat. Jesus took the cup as a visual reminder of the shed blood that would be given on the cross, that through his death and resurrection we may have peace with God and peace with one another. Again, as often as we drink of it, we should remember that Jesus leaves us his peace to give to others. Let's drink. May this peace guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Until he returns again, let's stand and let's sing together the doxology, and then we will be dismissed. There is a basket on the back seat for our benevolent offering. If you would like to give, help meet the needs of those who are less fortunate, that would be great. Let's sing together, shall we? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Go live out your faith. Shalom.